Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. And in this video, which is another episode of Deep Dive into RE Framework, we are going to cover the process transaction state in which the entire business logic or the major part of the business logic usually is placed in. And the transactions are processed that are fetched from the previous state, which is the get transaction data. And if there is no record to process, then it would transit to the end process state. And we'll see how does it transits to the end process state, because you would be wondering that there is no transition from the process transaction state to the end process state. But we'll be covering that how does it transit to the end process state. And also a very important thing which is there in the process transaction state, this RE framework has pre-built set transaction status workflow that can be used to set the transaction status of an item to either success or to business exception or application exception. And accordingly, you can take a call onto the different type of exception. And I have with me Nived also today here to ask in all the questions and doubts which he thinks people usually get it, and I'll try to clear it all. So let's get started. So coming to the process transaction state, if we see here, there are three transition states. So one is success, one is system exception, and the other is business exception. So in case of system exception, it is going back to the initialization state. In case of business exception, it is going to the get transaction data. And in case of success also, it is going to the get transaction data. So these are the three, you could say, the transitions that are coming out of process transaction state and one that is coming into the process transaction state. So
Anmol, I have a doubt. Yes. Like, can we add more exception scenarios apart from system exception, business exception and success?
So we can add it. We can even add in a more state other than these four states which are present, which we would maybe see later sometime in the video, but obviously we can do that. So we have here state machines that we can drag in to add more states even. So if I just drag in a state here, so this particular state would just be like any other or other remaining four states which are present in the RE framework, and we can make any transition to any number of states. And similarly, the same goes for the exception. So we'll just see later in the video that how can we add more exceptions if you want to, and how we can make.
So it depends upon the project actually.
Yes, entirely depends on the project and the architecture you design for your process. Okay. So process transaction, process a single transaction that is coming in from the get transaction data to the process transaction. So if we just go inside the process transaction here, so we have this business exception is equal to nothing.
And so why we said the business exception is nothing though?
Okay. So usually what happens that this is in this process.xaml, actually you call in all other workflows and you place in the entire logic of your process. Now, suppose you've got a business exception due to some data validation part or due to some data inaccuracy, and that is a business exception. So you would throw a business exception from inside this process.xaml. It would come outside. There is a catch. It would get catch here in this business rule exception. Now, it would then go to finally, because finally is something which has to be executed irrespective of there is an exception in your process or there is not an exception in your process. So I'll tell you that why do we set this business exception is equal to nothing. But yeah, just covering few things earlier to that. So we have said this business exception is equal to nothing. We also do this thing sometime that we even said in the system exception is nothing, and the why I'm going to cover in some time. Now what if we go inside this, so inside this we pass in our transaction item. So it could be anything. It could be a data row, it could be a queue item, it could be a mail message, it could be a string, it could be anything. And we pass in the config. And inside this, we actually place in all the logic. So suppose you have to download something from SAP or attach it somewhere, or you have to do a proper web automation inside it, or any sort of UI automation, Citrix automation, anything. So you place in the entire business logic here by making different workflows, dragging them, executing them. And if it's executed successfully, then also it comes out of this XAML. If it is not executed successfully due to some business exception or due to some application exception, then also it comes out of this process.xaml. And now we'll see that when it actually comes out, the control comes out of this process.xaml, then what happens? So first we'll be covering what happens if it's a success scenario or a happy scenario. So it came out here, everything is happy. It's a happy scenario, no exception. So it would not go into the catch block because it was all as expected. So it would then still go into the set transaction state. And in the set transaction state, if we see, what all are we passing is, so we are passing the config, we are passing the retry number, the transaction number, transaction field one, field two, ID, system exception, business exception. And as I've already shown that this transaction field one, field two, you can, you know, delete it, you can even add more. It's all entirely dependent on your project. So, and this retry number is that you create a global variable here, or it's usually already created by default when you select an RE framework, and its value is set to zero here. So that is the number which we are actually passing in the set transaction workflow. Now talking about the happy scenario. So it goes inside the set transaction status, and you have this, you could control logic flowchart type of thing here. So the first thing which you're going to check is, it's a success or not. So if it's a happy scenario and you have these two type of exceptions getting catched, which is the business exception and system exception, and if they both are nothing, that means it is a successful scenario. So it would go here in the success state. Okay. And here you can log something, or you want to close the application, open it again, and you can do all of those things here. Post that, what you're going to do is that now you have a transaction number, or you can say a row of Excel or an item of queue that has been executed. Now what you have to do is you have to pick another transaction item. And for that, what you're going to do is you just have to increase your or increment your transaction number. As we have seen in the get transaction data, that we increment the transaction number and we get in the next item. So here what we're going to do, we'll come out of this and we are going to increment our transaction number to plus one. So that now the next item is picked up. And we'll set in the retry number as zero. So that in case, if this particular thing has been retried once or twice before reaching to the success state, so we again mark it as zero, so that when next transaction item or transaction row comes in, so for that, the retry number is zero. That is starting afresh with each transaction row. Now, when the transaction number has been incremented by one, it would go back. It would come out of this thing even, and it would come here. And then it would again come out of this thing, because now the finally also has been executed. Because it is a success or a happy scenario, it would choose this path to go. Here we check that whether system exception is nothing and business exception is nothing. So if both the exceptions are null, that means it is a happy scenario. And we go in here. And now because we have incremented our transaction number, so we would then pass the incremented value here. And from like as an out argument, what are we getting is another row to process. And then we will go again back to transaction.
I have one more doubt.
Yeah.
Like, why the business exception also we are actually incrementing, we are moving to next transaction. It's a kind of exception. So why we are moving to next time session?
Okay. So see, exceptions can be categorized in a lot of ways, and that also depends on the project or on your use case, and you have to, you know, very wisely categorize the exception into business or system exception. So usually business exception is something due to data invalidity or due to data inaccuracy or something which is expected. That is that when the business also does this thing or the client even do this thing manually, they sometimes come across these situations, and this is how it is. If you're a particular invoice and you see the total amount is $200 and the business says no, that the total amount cannot be, you know, less than $300. So when you see that, okay, it's $200. So you have to notify the clients that it's $200 and it is less than $300 for this particular invoice, so that they are also aware and they can look into that manually, that what is the reason that why a particular vendor has sent in a invoice which is not matching that criteria. So in that case, there is no point of retrying. So usually this categorization is on the basis that in case of application exception, we retry it, because that is something related to our UI, or maybe something has not loaded completely because of which the bot broke. And if it's a data inaccuracy or if it's because of the data validation, then even if you retry, it's not going to change. So there's no point of retrying.
Yeah.
So that's...
One more question. Most of them said like application exception and system exception. Do both are same or both are different?
No, they both are same. So if you have anything related to the application, that you're opening a browser or you're opening a website or you're opening a SharePoint or some ERP tool, and if it's not getting loaded or if the bot is not able to click at a particular thing in the given time. So those are something related to the application, or you could say it's related to the system, or because it's taking too much time to load. So all those things come in the system exception or application exception. It's one and the same thing. So in that case, usually you retry, that if something is not loaded completely, you would retry. So that now if the response is quick, it would load completely and the bot would process. So that's how we decide. But then it depends that suppose if the business is given some, suppose the business says that this thing happens, but if you retry, it is fixed. So in that scenario, you would then need to retry even in the business exception. So then what you want to do, what you've done it here, that in case of business exception, you have incremented the transaction index, that is, do not retry and pick up the next item, then you're not going to do this thing. But usually that's not the case. You have to, you know, make that differentiation between the two type of exception, wherein you're going to retry and wherein you're not going to retry. If in the business exception, so you have to retry, then it would fall in the category of system exception only. So there has to be a clear distinction. So now from the process, if you have thrown a business exception, it would then again come to the final state, wherein you would again, you know, do something related to logging or this thing, or you would close the application to open it again so that you're on the home page. And then post doing all that, what you're going to do, you would just, you know, increment the transaction index to pick up the next item. And here, when it's not success, then also you check that whether it's business or it's system. And accordingly, you go in one of these. Now coming to the most important thing, that how you actually retry. And that is usually in the case of system exception. Before going to that, so you asked me that why do we set this thing as nothing. So suppose there was a business exception in transaction number one. You went to final state, you incremented the transaction number. So you came here, it was a business exception, you have incremented the transaction index. It came out here and so it came out here, then it would come out of this thing also, and it would go to get transaction data to get in the next item. Now, because this business exception and system exceptions are the thing that, you know, are, they are the global variables. Now, if you have not set that particular business exception variable to nothing, so that variable would still carry the exception of the previous transaction number. And now when you go inside and you have not set it as nothing, so you would go then in the process transaction state, you would do the work. And even if that particular thing is success, it would get cached in here. Okay. Or what happens that if the catch though wouldn't work, that because you're not actually throwing, but finally, anyways, you're going to come to finally. And now because the previous one, you have not set it to nothing, you'll come here and you will check that that system exception, business exception, both are nothing. But because you have not set it to nothing, it would contain in the message of the previous exception. And this would become false. Then it would come here and it would check not nothing, but it's not, it has the exception message of the previous transaction. So it would go in business exception. So even though your transaction was a successful one, it would lead to a business exception thing only because you have not set it to nothing.
That is the importance of setting it as nothing.
Yeah, it is very important to set it as nothing, because once if you have got a business exception and you have not set it to nothing, then all the other transactions next to it would be marked as business exception, even though they were successful. So it would lead to a blunder if you don't do this thing.
Got this point now.
And same goes for system exception, because once if you are retrying it in case of system exception and you have not set it to nothing, then even when you are retrying, what are you getting is that you have the system exception. So there's no point of retrying if you're not setting it to nothing.
But in defaultly reframe work, we are not providing the system exception as nothing here in the process state.
Sorry, come again.
Like in the process transaction, process state, if you look, the system exception is not provided as nothing there, as assigned there.
Okay, so it must be taken care somewhere. So we'll just have to look, because this also happens that if you just, you know, double click on this, you can even drop in action activities here. So what you can do is, if you're not assigning it there, you can even assign that thing over here. So you can drag in n number of activities in the action even. You can do system exception as nothing. You can mark the retry number to be incremented. You can mark the retry number to be zero, or you can, you know, send in the mails from here to the support team or to the clients. Now coming back to the backbone of this whole RE thing and the process transaction state, that is the retry part. So if we go to set transaction state, now if it's a system exception, we come in here to this particular workflow. And now the two things, that if it's a queue retry and if it's a normal retry in case of data table, in case of mail message, in case of arrays, you do a normal retry on that particular transaction item. So here you check in the queue retry. So it would only be a queue retry when you get in this transaction item dot get type. So you get the type of the transaction item and you check that whether it's a queue item or not. If it's a queue item, then what you're going to do is, then you are setting in transaction item dot retry number. That is, you get the retry number of the queue from here. So when you create the queues, you set it as auto retry, yes or no. If you set it as yes, you define in the maximum number of retries. If you set it to no, then you don't have to describe, or you could say declare this thing to enter the maximum number of retries.
Okay.
And then you go to the retry current transaction or XAML, in which actually the retry happens. So the first thing which is checked is, in the config, you already have this variable created, which is maximum retry number. So it checks that whether the value is greater than zero or not. If you keep it zero, that means you don't want to retry. So it would simply increment the transaction number to pick the next transaction. The case which happens usually in the case of success or in the case of business exception. That is, we don't retry, we just increment the transaction number. But if you have the maximum retry number in your config set to a value greater than zero, one, two. So if it's one, then you want to retry one time, which means one time when the actual flow is going. If it breaks, then you want to retry one more time. That's it. If it is two, that means total three times. One is the actual flow and two retries if the actual flow or the actual control fails. So if it is greater than zero, that means you want to retry. So then you check that whether the retry which we are doing, has it exceeded the maximum retry number? So suppose if your maximum retry is two and you have already retried two times. So it will check that our retry number, has it exceeded? If it has exceeded the maximum retry number, then it would not retry. So then what it is going to do is, it would log, it would set in the retry number as zero. So that for the next transaction number which we are picking, it has this fresh start, that is the retry number is zero for it. So that if that particular transaction number fails, then that also gets a chance to the number of retries which has been set in config file. It is the same that if we do not set it as zero, the same what I've explained for that, what if we do not set in the business exception to nothing, the same goes for this.
Got it.
So now if the maximum retry number has been reached, so we just increment the transaction number to pick in the next item. But if the maximum retry number has not been reached, then we check, use orchestrator's retry. So that is in queue retry. And how are we getting this thing? If we just go back here, so we are getting it from here. So this queue retry is a Boolean variable. If you just see from the variables pane, so it's a Boolean variable. So queue retry means that in case of queue, if you're using queue in your RE framework, then only this would get true. And you're passing this thing to this particular retry current transaction workflow. So see, you're passing queue retry to in queue retry. So if it's in queue retry, that means we are using queues. So if we're using it, then what are we going to do? We would increment the transaction number, which is that what happens in case of queue retry, if you just retry the queue because it has failed. So what happens is that the transaction item, which is at present, would get failed and it would create another transaction item. Or I'll just explain. So suppose you are having a queue item one and this particular thing failed because of some system exception. Okay. And this queue item one was having data, you can say A, B, C, and this failed. So what is going to happen that the bot would mark this particular queue item as retry or as failed, and would, because you have to, you want to retry and you are, you have this retry mechanism in place and you want to retry. So what is going to happen is that it would create another queue item and it would be two with the same value and its status would be new. So when you are retrying in case,
so that would be picked by the next case. Yes. It would be
So because it has created this only particular thing which you have to execute again, but with another value, or you could say with another index, which is new. So if you want to process this when you are retrying, so what you have to do is you have to increment your transaction number, because now what you had in one is now present in two. So that's why what we do is we increment the transaction number. But if it's not a Q retry, then what we do normally is we increment the retry number. This retry number is nothing but the global variable of the retry number which we have created, with which we can keep a track on that whether the maximum retry has been reached or not. And yeah, so that's all. That's how you retry. And now when we come out of this retry transaction, so we have this take screenshot, try taking screenshot.
What is the use of this take screenshot workflow?
Okay. So when this whole process or whole solution is being deployed on a server or on some or on client machine, so what happens that when you get any error, so suppose your bot was trying to download something from some site, from some website, and you got some error. So when you get that error, so it would come to this set transaction status only in case of error. It would do all those things that whether we have to retry or not, and if it's a queue item or not, and then what is the retry account. It would check all those things, come out of that retry current transaction XAML, and then would take a screenshot on the, of the screen on which the bot was operating. And you can, you know, specify that where you want to get this screenshot saved. So you have this X screenshot folder path, key present in config, and if you just place in the path, so you've given a path of your D drive there in the config. So whatever, wherever the bot is trying to click and it failed due to some XYZ reason, you would actually see the snip. So suppose it was trying to log into the website.
Like my question is, for example, if you are clicking on some button, like login button to log to a website, at that time it failed. At that time, what even though this everything, this reframework is completely built in this try catch method, it will catch up that actually pop up or the error pop up. So what is the use of taking that particular screenshot?
Okay.
Actually.
So suppose your bot was trying to kill, trying to log in, but your the site was down. The site on which it was trying to log into was not up and running, and it was down due to some maintenance thing. You would never get to know that, that why did it really fail, until and unless you open the server and you run the bot and you sit in front of it and you wait and see that why it's not logging, then only you'll get to know. But instead of doing that whole thing that you log into that server, if you just go to the that folder wherein the screenshot is placed and you just open that thing, so you'll just get to see that, okay, the site is down and it's under maintenance, and that's why the bot wasn't able to log in. So in such scenarios, and there are a lot of such scenarios, I'm just, you know, giving an example. So in that, in such scenarios, this take screenshot is very useful. And also if your client someday came up to you and asked that why didn't the bot process on this, this day. So you would have all this, you know, like to prove to present that, okay, your, this was something, this problem was at your end, or this was something related to system and had nothing to do with the code or had nothing to do with the bot. It would even help us in debugging, and, you know, so that we do not put in a lot of time or put in a lot of effort in diagnosing that what is the cause. If there is any such cause of system not running, or if the password is expired and things like that. So that would just get captured, and you would just have to, you know, go through those snips or snaps, and it would get to know. And this also has been put in try catch, because if it fails due to some reason, then it gets logged accordingly that what is the message. And then at last you close all the applications, but then this is entirely dependent on the use case. But usually this happens that when it is a system exception, you usually close all the applications that are involved in the process, because you would never know that on which screen actually the bot is at present, even if you're retrying, or if you know it, or if you somehow know that how to, you know, bring it back onto the home screen by checking few selectors, then obviously you can skip this try closing applications. But it is all dependent on the process, that if you're really aware of that on which screen it is and how you're going to bring it back to the home screen from where the next transaction has to pick up processing. So based on all those things, you can decide on on what all applications you have to close or on what all process you have to kill. So once all this is done, you've decided on whether to retry or not, or retry has been reached or not. Then you come outside. And if I talk about the main thing, the other two transitions which are going. So in case of system exception, you're going back to the init state. In case of business exception, wherein you are checking that business exception is not nothing. That is, you are having some business exception. You're just going back to get transaction data to bring in the next item because you don't have to retry. But in case of system exception, you're having system exception is not nothing. And in that case, you're going back to the init state. And that's why you have placed this config is nothing over here, so that if you're retrying, you need not to read the config again. Also, there's one more thing which you can do is, here you are checking the same thing, system exception is not nothing. And if there's no data, you're going back to the end process state. Also,
one my query, like in process transaction, we are actually doing the transaction processing. So can we do, or can we place an activity which actually opens the browser or opens the application in the process state? Is it a good practice to keep it in the process state?
See, there's no harm in opening any application, opening any browser or things like that in process transaction state. It would not fall in the bad practice. It is all dependent on the, you know, type of process you're dealing in. If you're opening a browser, you're opening any application. So there is no good practice or bad practice related to that, that you have to keep it only in init or you have to keep it only in process transaction state. It's entirely dependent on the project. You can even put that thing in some other state which you have introduced other than these four states. You can keep it in init. You can keep it in process. It's the type of architecture you decide on. Okay. So, So one more thing what you can check is that when you're retrying, you're coming back to init. What if the maximum retry has reached? If the maximum retry has reached, then also you have to pick up the next transaction item, or you have to, you know, end the process. Those things also can be decided accordingly. So one thing is that, you know, if the maximum retry has reached, so you pick another transaction item. And for that also, you can add in a condition here that if is business exception is not nothing, then also go to get transaction data to pick in the next item. Or you can add this thing that or if system exception is not nothing, and also that along with this, if retry number is now greater than config maximum retry number, you can place in the value key here this thing that if system exception is not nothing, okay, you have to convert it to cint.
To integer format.
That's it. So either your business exception is there or your system exception is there and you have exceeded the retry number for that particular transaction item, then also you can come back to get transaction data and pick up the next item. And if all the items have already been processed, then you can move to end process state. Also, you can do this thing that if you do not want to go back to the initialization state in case of system exception, you can do this thing that you retry it here only, and like this, you can do this thing, you retry it here only. So if you're initializing any application in the init state, then you would have to do it here. You can do it here, over here.
So that dot will depend upon the project.
Yeah, it totally depends on the architecture. So it's like I would have different perception and different view of the architecture. You would have different, another person would have it different. It totally depends on the perception and also on the project you're dealing in and on the design of the architecture you decide on. So accordingly, you can keep manipulating and keep modifying the default RE framework template, which is there. So yeah, that's all. I think I've covered everything related to the process transaction state. Nivedita, you have any other questions?
No, Anmol. Everything is covered.
Okay. So in the next video, we're going to see the end process state, wherein we'll end the entire project thing, that how do we go to end process state and what all we can do there in end process state. Till then, stay tuned to my channel, and thanks for watching the video, and don't forget to like, share and subscribe.